Cricket's Bearded Wonder. Bill Frindall recalls the voices and characters of Test Match Special, written and read by Bill Frindall.
John Arlott, one of radio's most celebrated broadcasters, arrived a few minutes before play started, wearing a camouflage mesh jacket and carrying an enormous briefcase, which I assumed contained his library for that match. It didn't. It contained his lunch. Two bottles of claret, a large wine glass, a vine root corkscrew, cheese, biscuits, a plate, cutlery, and underneath them all, Cricket's pocket Bible, Playfair. We were introduced, and John immediately tried to put me at ease. His first words to me were, "Hello, welcome. What do you give to the woman who's got everything?" The scene was a cramped, ramshackle eyrie, set on stilts, overlooking a rain-swept cricket ground at Worcester. Even months of meticulous research and a dawn arrival for my first cricket broadcast hadn't prepared me for such a question. "Encouragement," I ventured. He growled triumphantly, "No, penicillin." My dismay at failing to answer such an obvious riddle was swiftly removed by the great man's next remarks. "I hear you like driving. Well, I like drinking. We're going to get on well." And we did for 15 wonderful summers until John hung up his microphone and moved his library and cellar to the Channel Islands. One of the thirstiest souls ever to have been let loose on this planet, the sage of Alsford took me under his wing like a surrogate son and immediately filled me with confidence and Chardonnay. With a scorecard and stopwatch as his only props, he proceeded to give a 3-minute match preview for the BBC World Service. Finishing precisely within his allotted time, he opened his case to reveal the famous lunch. It rained for most of the 3 days, and my baptism was painless. John's kindness towards and interest in novice writers and broadcasters was unlimited. He was to have a tremendous influence on my life. No one helped me more with sage advice and encouragement during that first season. After the first session of my debut at Worcester, he inspired much-needed confidence by saying, "You'll do. You've got a scorer's mind. You can focus on the play and obliterate everything happening in this box." Few people are destined to spend their working lives indulging in their favourite hobby. To earn a living doing something you would gladly do for free is everyone's dream. Hooked on cricket since the age of 8, when a great uncle took me to watch a club match at Beckenham, I often dreamt of playing for England, but never did I expect to be granted more than 40 summers and several winters watching international cricket from the best seat in the house. Every life has its key moments. Some may emerge only through hindsight, while others are glaringly apparent as soon as they happen. My decision to apply for the role of Test Match Special's scorer statistician when Arthur Wrigley suddenly passed away became a key moment only when I was eventually offered the job. Even that inspired piece of obituary watching would not have occurred had I not been taught to score by a desperate master on a rainy day at primary school. A few days later, I was taken to a match where they needed a scorer, and a remarkable career was born. Timing is everything, though, and had I not just ended a 7-year stint in the RAF shortly before my predecessor's demise, I would have been unable to apply for his job. But I'm jumping the gun. My innings began at Epsom in Surrey on the 3rd of March 1939, exactly 6 months before Neville Chamberlain called play in the Hitler War. I went to school at Tadworth County Primary, and when I was 10, one of the staff, Jack Glenister, was to provide the key moment that was to shape the rest of my life by teaching me how to score a cricket match. It all happened by accident. One day, afternoon games were rained off, so during the lunch break, Mr. Glenister chalked up the entire layout of a scorebook page on the blackboard. We then played an imaginary innings, filling in the score on pages torn out of an old scorebook. I was absolutely enthralled, and the 2 hours sped past. A few days later, I was asked if I could score for the local Temple Bar second 11. Jack Glenister must have taught me well, because I scored for them for the remainder of the season, and I was now completely hooked on the game. In 1950, I gained a place at Reigate Grammar School. My first sight of live professional cricket came a year later when Dad took me to Kennington Oval to watch Surrey in a championship match against Middlesex. Over the next few seasons, I spent many happy hours with Dad at the Oval. He used to write sick notes for me. And it wasn't until my final year at Reigate that any member of staff twigged I was only ill when Surrey were playing at home. I played cricket for the Reigate Grammar School First 11. I also got picked for my local Banstead Cricket Club and another Sunday side as a new ball bowler and lower order batsman. Meanwhile, in the sixth form, I became fascinated by the history of architecture, and I was awarded a Surrey exhibition and a place at Kingston School of Art. But my career in architecture lasted precisely one term. I hadn't realised the amount of study involved and how it would interfere with my cricket. I also only wanted to design cathedrals. Another reason was Dad's deteriorating health. Having terminated my full-time education, I was now liable for 2 years of national service, and I joined the Royal Air Force in December 1958. I rather enjoyed life in the RAF, especially the statistical work, while the opportunities for playing cricket appeared endless. One season, I played in 50 matches spread over 9 counties and bowled 498 overs and 5 balls. I signed on for a further 5 years, got married, and played even more cricket before I was posted to France. There I worked in a NATO war room in the bowels of Fontainebleau Forest, rehearsing World War III badly. We lost 17-3 while I was there. The long periods of concentration would prove to be excellent practice for my 6 and 7 hour stints on Test Match Special. My RAF CO recommended me for a commission, and I was promoted to the rank of flying officer. But after serving for 6 and a half cricket seasons, I decided not to prolong my service career, and I left in 1965. By then, my father had died from a heart attack at the age of only 54, leaving my mother alone in Epsom. My sole aim when I left the RAF was to find work in cricket, preferably involving administration or reporting. I never even considered scoring. I was 25 and I had a young family to support, so I was prepared to take any work until the right opportunity presented itself. Meanwhile, I continued playing cricket for Banstead and occasionally as a guest for the Legal and General Assurance Society's team Temple Bar, with whom I had begun my scoring career. While I was waiting to bat for them, I was headhunted. They just happened to be looking for a trainee insurance inspector in their city office. Although the work sounded fairly unexciting, it had the great advantage of being flexible. Inspectors could check on their agents during the morning and play cricket in the afternoon. This had enormous appeal. After the briefest interview, I began work in Fenchurch Street. Then, on the 30th of October 1965, Arthur Wrigley, the BBC's radio scorer since 1934, died of cancer in a Stockport hospital following emergency surgery. His premature demise proved to be the key moment of them all, and my life changed. Arthur was only 53 and had pioneered a role born out of Hedley Verity's phenomenal bowling performance against Australia at Lord's in 1934 when he took 15 wickets for 104 runs. In those early days of cricket broadcasting, test matches were covered by a lone reporter accompanied by an engineer with all his gear housed in a haversack. Initially, the MCC would not permit live broadcasting from within the Lord's ground, and Howard Marshall, the BBC cricket reporter, had to broadcast from a room rented in a house nearby. On one occasion, he had to halt a piano lesson in the room above. At the 1934 test, Marshall was broadcasting his reports from a tiny balcony above the home dressing room. During the final hour on the third day, when Verity took the last 6 wickets, Marshall's reports were in constant demand. He was compelled to provide virtually ball-by-ball commentary without a scorer and with only a primitive scoreboard visible. He had no idea what Verity's figures were. It was to be England's only Ashes victory at Lord's in the 20th century. When Marshall returned to Broadcasting House, he asked for a scorer for the third test at Old Trafford. He was flatly refused and advised to bribe a ground staff boy with a 2-guinea match fee. Marshall went to the office of the Lancashire secretary, Captain Howard. He was in luck. Lancashire had just signed a young leg spinner onto their ground staff, and he also happened to be training as an accountant. His name was Arthur Wrigley, and he became the first BBC scorer and statistician. His 31-year reign was broken only by wartime service in the RAF and occasional appearances by Roy Webber or Jack Price. I heard the news of Arthur's death on a radio bulletin. Having been a devoted listener to radio commentaries since 1950, I had heard his name mentioned many times. Very occasionally, he was permitted to say something. In 1957, during my final year at Reigate Grammar School, I'd been allowed to study in the prefect's room, and I used to listen to the Test match commentaries on the radio. That 1957 season was the first in which BBC Radio broadcast Test cricket ball by ball throughout the day, and saw the introduction of the programme's current name, Test Match Special. It was a memorable series against the West Indies, and the commentary had provided compulsive listening. Now, 8 years later, I wondered who would score for TMS the following summer. Then came the vision. I could score. I'd collected a reasonable number of cricket books, and I knew a fair amount of cricket history. The RAF had trained me in statistics and accountancy. I'd served for 2 years in a NATO war room and had learnt to concentrate for long periods. So I looked up the BBC's phone number and asked the operator there who was in charge of cricket. After much research, he told me it was Mr. Charles Max Muller, and he was head of outside broadcast Bracket Sound, not radio. I wrote to him, and to my amazement, I received a reply a few days later inviting me for an interview. It was the first time I had seen Broadcasting House, let alone entered that historic Art Deco sanctuary. A secretary took me to the head of OB's office. Inside were Charles Max Muller, seated behind a formidably exalted desk, cricket producer Michael Chuke Hastings, and the jovial cricket correspondent Brian Johnston. I had met Johnners when he had played in a memorial match for a player from Ashton Cricket Club a few weeks earlier. I meekly accepted the offer of a cup of tea. The rattle of the cup on the saucer revealed the state of my nerves. Max Muller broke the ice by asking what had made me think I could do Wrigley's job. I told them about my scoring history and RAF training. Then I handed round the three loose-leaf scrapbooks I had kept containing scores, reports, cuttings and photos of my playing career. Luckily, Brian turned to a purple passage where I had taken 20 wickets in three innings on dodgy pitches in Lincolnshire. He exclaimed, "I don't know about scoring for us, he'd better bloody well play." After the briefest discussion, Mr. Max Muller offered me regular Saturday scoring work at 8 guineas a day. They felt duty-bound to offer the test matches to two others, Michael Fordham and Arnold Whipp, who had regularly scored for them at county matches. I accepted the Saturday work only provisionally because I was reluctant to end my Saturday playing career. League cricket was about to be introduced to the South, Banstead were to play in the new Surrey Championship, and I had established myself as an opening bowler in the first 11. I returned to my Fenchurch Street training and kept quiet about the BBC offer. Mike Smith's MCC team was touring Australia, and I rose early to practice my scoring from the radio commentaries on the final hour's play. I also worked out the touring team's batting and bowling averages. When I compared them with those published in the national press, there were a considerable number of discrepancies. Those averages were compiled by the Press Association. I visited their offices in Fleet Street.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.